When the President of the United States is a corrupt and lazy, narcissistic clown and Alexander Hamilton has become the subject of a smash hit hip-hop musical, you might think the game would be up for the rhetoric and idealism surrounding the birth of the American Republic. In such circumstances, the Federalist Papers, which are so often described as a classic in political science unrivaled by any subsequent American writer, might seem utterly redundant, even irrelevant. Nothing could be further from the truth. America is a society constructed of words, and the Federalist Papers stand alongside the Declaration of Independence and the U.S. Constitution as the most sustained and deeply serious attempt to clarify what it was that the Founding Fathers had set in motion on the 4th of July 1776. Publius, along with Mark Twain, the only pseudonym admitted to this series, concealed the identities of three great American founding fathers, Alexander Hamilton, James Madison, and John Jay, who, respectively, contributed 52, 28 and 5 of the 85 short approximately 1,001,500-word essays that make up a document that, in the words of one critic, lies at the very core of American governance. Indeed, the author of the Declaration of Independence, Thomas Jefferson, declared these papers to be the best commentary on the principles of government ever written. The Federalist Papers were composed and published very fast, in serial form, in response to an urgent, post-revolutionary crisis in which the anti-federalist movement had begun seriously to challenge the Federal Union. 77 of the essays were published almost continuously in the Independent Journal and the New York Packet between October 1787 and August 1788 and collected in book form later that same year. This would be added to, and revised, in subsequent editions up to 1802. At this vital moment in the making of the United States, there was, said Hamilton, nailing the argument, only one question at stake: whether societies of men are really capable or not of establishing good government from reflection and choice, or whether they are forever destined for their political constitutions on accident and force. Addressing a debate that reverberates to the present day, Hamilton and Madison made a brilliant and powerful case for the Union. In essay number 9, the words are Hamilton's: "We see their breadth of wisdom and learning. It is impossible to read the history of the petty republics of Greece and Italy without feeling sensations of horror and disgust at the distractions with which they were continually agitated, and at the rapid successions of revolutions by which they were kept in a state of perpetual vibration between the extremes of tyranny and anarchy." To this, Jay added his own voice. In another powerful essay, "Nothing is more certain than the indispensable necessity of government, and it is equally undeniable that whenever and however it is instituted, the people must cede to it some of their natural rights, in order to vest it with requisite powers." In such a situation, said Jay, Americans had to ask themselves the one question that would eventually morph into the debate about states' rights: whether it would conduce more to the interests of the people that they should be one nation, under one federal government, than that they should divide themselves into separate confederacies. Who knows how many Americans ever fully engaged with the complex and enthralling ideas embodied in this remarkable, and strangely passionate, text at the time. These essays were avidly consumed by voters and readers in New York, to whom they were addressed. Hamilton seems to have encouraged the reprinting of his work in newspapers outside New York State and in several other states where the ratification debate was raging. In reality, they appeared irregularly outside New York, and in other parts of the country, where they were often overshadowed by local writers addressing local issues, a phenomenon that persists. In the long run, what was really influential, as many have pointed out, was the rhetorical dignity and decorum expressed in these polemical pages. Publius was learned, wise, tolerant and, above all, rational. He was a figure of the Enlightenment who believed in secular society and secular government. And perhaps he wasn't wrong. The U.S. Constitution is still going strong, in some ways now more so than ever. Despite the ugliest rhetoric ever witnessed within the Union, America is not broken, though possibly not in the best of health. That it should draw any political breath at all, in the current circumstances, is due significantly to the writings of men such as Hamilton, Madison, and Jay. There were, of course, nuances of difference between the three authors behind Publius. Madison and Hamilton would ultimately have a bitter falling out, but their collective support for the much-disputed U.S. Constitution is clear and unequivocal. Interestingly, in the light of the current political situation, they assigned the Supreme Court only a very limited role in the overall system of government. "Of the three powers above mentioned," writes Hamilton, "the judiciary is next to nothing. It's an irony of history that Publius would have appreciated that, in the present emergency, it's precisely the judiciary that is everything. A signature sentence. I will only add that, prior to the appearance of the Constitution, I rarely met with an intelligent man from any of the states who did not admit, as a result of experience, that the unity of the executive of this state was one of the best of the distinguishing features of our Constitution. 3. To compare Thomas Jefferson Autobiography 1821 Benjamin Franklin Autobiography 1793 Ulysses S. Grant Personal Memoirs 1885 The Federalist Papers by Publius is available in Penguin Classics £9.95. To order a copy go to bookshop.theguardian.com or call 0330-333-6846. Free UKPP over £10, online orders only. Phone orders min pp of £1.99.